बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, अस्सलामु अलैकुम। लास्ट टाइम आई डिस्कस्ड कंजेनिटल फीचर्स एंड स्टार्टेड विद डिक्टाइलोग्राफी एंड टोल्ड यू टिल रिकॉर्डिंग ऑफ फिंगरप्रिंट्स। नाउ आफ्टर दैट नेक्स्ट हेडिंग टुडे इज व्हाट इज application and or use of fingerprints. So following points will tell you about its use or application. Number one is recognition of chance impressions at scene of crime. So because every criminal uses his hands in an unlawful act, so even if he has fled from the scene of crime, he leaves prints somewhere at scene, which are collected by police. So that is number one application or use, collection of impressions found at scene of crime. Number two application is identification of weapon used. So if criminal has left any weapon by chance at scene of crime and he has his fingerprints marks, so then that can be matched with his data and it can be proved that this is the weapon used by the criminal. Number three, identification of criminals, amnesic persons, dead persons, unconscious persons after accidents. So in all these cases, fingerprints are taken and then analyzed and identity is determined, provided there is a record of their fingerprints already with police. Because police has almost a data of all criminals and their record is with police, so they can match it. Number four, identification of decomposed or mutilated bodies of unknown persons. So even in those bodies, if the soft tissue is available, still it may be decomposed, but still these prints can be studied and collected. Next is prevention of impersonation or detection of impersonation, and next is as precaution on checks, banknotes and legal documents. So as you know, when someone writes a check, he makes his signature, but in addition to make it more accurate or secure, he can use his fingerprint or thumb impression so that no one else can get it cashed. So these are some of the applications of fingerprinting. Next is, what are advantages of using fingerprints? So these are, number one, it is applicable to persons of all ages. As you know, as opposed to anthropometry, which is only applicable for adults, this fingerprinting or dactylography is applicable for all ages, right from day one to till death of that person, and even in dead persons, as long as their tissues can be don't decompose. Number two, prints can be obtained even from putrefied bodies. So that I have told you just now, that putrefied bodies also, dermis is exposed, epidermis is removed, but it has prints on it. Number third advantage is absolute identification is possible. Now, what is absolute identification? That is complete, without doubt, or positive identity of the person can be maintained. It's not partial or incomplete. So, because it is pattern is unique, so it can be easily determined that who is this person. Number four, no specific training, experience, or instrument is required. So it's very simple procedure: recording of fingerprints, as you know, and then some fingerprint experts in police they can analyze and study by matching with their record. Number five, actual print is always available to compare with suspected ones. Number six, prints can be transmitted from one place to another by internet. This is called AFIS. So that is automated fingerprint system, and this is now with the help of internet. So it is very easy to send a print from one place to another within no time. So it can save a lot of time and energy and effort. Number seven, prints can be preserved for very long time. So they are not destroyed very easy, and they can be preserved, and hence whenever it is needed, they can be studied. So these are few advantages of dactylography. So with that, this congenital feature is over, and next is DNA profiling, DNA fingerprinting, or DNA typing is the same thing. And this is also very important and very reliable method of determination of identity, like dactylography. So today in this lecture, first I have told you something about remaining portion of dactylography. Then now I am going to tell you about DNA, and after that I will take up acquired features. Now these were congenital: dactylography, anthropometry, and DNA. They are congenital features. And then after that I will take up acquired features in which only one I will describe, that is tattoo marks. So now coming back to DNA, it is a surest method of identity, like dactylography. We have one state-of-the-art forensic science lab in Lahore where this test is performed. It works on the principle that structure of each person's DNA is unique, with the exception of identical twins. So that is the principle on which DNA technique works. Now, what are samples which are collected for DNA profile? Now these tissues must contain nucleated cells. So what are those tissues which contain cells? Like leukocytes, semen, brain, bone marrow, muscle, skin, teeth, hair with root sheath, and dried stains. So these cells or tissues in very small amount are required. That is, as you know, what is trace evidence. So even if they are found in trace amounts on the scene of crime or from the body of victim or body of assailant, they can be collected and then subjected to DNA test. Now how this test is performed, or what is the method, or what is the actual procedure, that is matching. So matching is done. And how matching is done? Identity of a criminal is determined by comparing the accused DNA with a biological item, that is sample like blood, semen, stains, etc. found at scene of crime. So what happens is, at scene of crime something is collected like a dry stain, and then forensic science lab has data of all suspected persons, and so it is matched with those data. And then if accused DNA data is present, then it will match. That is called matching, and this will confirm the identity of the criminal. So this matching is done, and this type of test is acceptable to law courts. So now, what is forensic importance of DNA or legal importance? So this technique or method is used in the following situations of medico-legal importance. As its name suggests, almost all the criminal acts and disputes are brought to courts by victim or police to seek remedies and justice. And in majority of cases, medical examination and report is a legal requisite, and it greatly facilitates victim. So DNA typing has gained importance and is applicable in following cases or situations. Number one, in cases of physical assault or homicides. That means the person or victim may die as a result of physical assault. So if assailant is unknown or escapes or denies the allegation, then DNA technique will confirm or rule out his involvement. Because if any of his tissue is found on body of victim or on scene of crime, then it will be clear that same person has done this act. Number two, sexual assault or rape cases. Now this crime is on rise in our country with women and children especially. For example, there was a child Zainab, that case is very famous, and other cases. So she was raped and killed by a person well known to her and her family. No one was suspecting him, but he was caught by DNA test and he confessed. So number three is determination of sex. As we have discussed in intersex states and in doubtful cases of sex, in to solve inheritance and other issues like marriage, DNA test can be used to confirm sex of the person if it is doubtful. Now, what is paternity dispute? Where more than one person's claim to be parents of a child for custody. So there DNA test is done on the order of courts to confirm who is the real parent of that child. Next is immigration. Many countries, they require that for giving immigration to someone, they need DNA test to determine the or confirm the identity of that person. Next is linking body parts in mass disaster, like earthquakes, plane crashes, railway accidents, etc., where so many people die and their body parts may be separated from main body and scattered. So the experts collect them, and there are other methods too other than DNA, like anthropologist or anatomist, they can work on them, but to make further sure DNA test can link together those different scattered body parts and restore that body to hand it over to their family and bury. Now, next application may be baby mix-up in maternity wards, where several newborns are born on the same time or day and they look like the same and they can be easily mixed up. So there, if there is a dispute, then DNA will help. Next is identity of a person with memory loss. For example, some foreign person, some traveler, who has lost all his documents and doesn't have memory somehow, no documentation and no other evidence of identity, so DNA can determine his or confirm identity. So these are some of the applications of DNA technique for the purpose of law and courts, and that means forensic importance of DNA. With that, DNA is finished, and next are acquired features. So from acquired feature, I will take up tattoo marks. So what are other acquired features? They are scar marks, acquired malformations such as malunited fractures, dental extractions and fillings, diseases like poliomyelitis and other deformities. So these are features are acquired, that means after birth they are produced due to some disease or some pathology or some voluntary addition like tattoo marks. So what are tattoo marks? They are designs formed by multiple small punctured wounds in skin up to superficial layers of dermis by needles or penetrating tools dipped in a dye. So I hope everyone knows about tattoo marks. They are produced or designs. Their designs are some picture or some like something in writing. Anything can be, and they are produced by some needles which of multiple color needles, which can produce those designs on the body with different colors and shapes and designs. Now, are they permanent or temporary? It mostly depends on type of the dye and depth of the tattoos and part of the body on which they are applied. Now, blue, black and red colors are more durable, so they are commonly used. Now, how they can be examined by an examiner? By different methods are there, but like high contrast photography, ultraviolet rays, light infrared photography, computer image enhancement, all these techniques are there to examine and inspect these tattoo marks. On unidentified putrefied bodies, if loose epidermis is removed, these tattoo mark becomes more sharp on photograph. So putrefied bodies, they become more visible, and so it is easier to examine them. Now, sometimes on autopsy, if a relative or family member or friend, he points out to examiner that there was a tattoo mark on forearm or upper arm of a person, but on autopsy he doesn't find it. So that makes identity confused or doubtful, but actually those tattoo marks, they go to regional lymph nodes. Those dyes or those inks, they disappear from there in the same person and they move to lymph nodes, so that lymph nodes may be examined to confirm that. Now these tattoo marks can be altered. Sometimes they are changed, sometimes they are removed, or sometimes the second one is superimposed to conceal identity. Maybe some spies or some suspected criminals, they are well known for their tattoos, so they will like to change them, eliminate them, or add another one on it so as to deny their identity as criminal. So how we can describe a tattoo mark on examination? So you will note the following. You will note the color of the tattoo mark. You will note the size, how much big it is. You will also note design, what does it show. And you will also note the anatomical situation. So where it is located. And is it close to some anatomical landmark, you will mention it. You will mention the region of the body, like upper chest, lower chest, upper back, lower back. So wherever it is, you will give some anatomical clue. So these are a few ways to describe, and you can take photograph or sketch of that tattoo. Now why this description is done? Because as a doctor, as an examiner, one is supposed to take a note down and write down and provide this information to the courts. Now what are the complications of tattoo marks? What problems they can create? So these are mainly due to sepsis and transmission of diseases like AIDS, hepatitis, syphilis and tuberculosis, because if the same needles are used from so these things, viruses can be transmitted from a sick person to a healthy person. Now what is medico-legal importance of tattoo marks or tattoos? So they may indicate personal identity. How they indicate this? Some people, they can write or imprint their name, date of marriage, date of birth, name of spouse or some friend. So this, if this is found on tattoos, then it gives the identity of that person. Now how they can help in race determination? Some races like Japanese, they are fond of making or getting tattoos on chest and limbs. So these are their favorite sites. So any person having on chest and limb, you can think of him maybe a Japanese. Now how they give you religion of a person. Now if you find designs of Hanuman, Krishna, that means the person may be a Hindu. If you find some tattoos of cross or Christ, the person may be a Christian. Or if you find some tattoos like sword or crescent, the person may be Muslim. Or if someone is having tattoo a star, which is sign of Israel or Jews, so these different religions, people show their affiliation or their religions by getting such type of tattoos. Now professions and occupations by tattoos. Some criminals, gangs have specific tattoos. So every one of member of the gang has that design or tattooing on his body. Some occupation like coal miners working in coal mine, they have tattoos on hand and face from the material they handle in coal mine. Now behavioral characteristics. Now these are interesting. Blue bird design. If you find blue bird design on the extensor surface of thumb of a person, that may be homosexual, because that is sign of homosexuality. Now some drug users, they have number 13 tattoo inside the lower lip, so he may be drug addict. Some other addicts, or many addicts, they have multiple injection sites on their body because they get heroin or cocaine or some other drug by injection, and they want to conceal those injection sites, so they get tattoos on those areas to conceal injection marks. So social status, how social status we can get from tattoos is that in India especially, the lower class of society, they are more prone or more fond of getting tattoos on their body. Now political convictions. Now just like professional, politics is also important, and so those people, they can, those who are political minded, if they are fond of tattoos, they can get their party signs like sword, sickle, cow and calf, or whatever, tiger, whatever their sign, party sign, they can get tattoos of those on their body. Now it is a fashion among stars, film stars, movie stars, TV stars, models and elite class rich people, they get they are more in habit of getting tattoos all over body or on genitalia. They on genitalia may show the person is sexually perverted, and so these type of tattoos are usually common on sexually perverted people. So these were few points which give you the medico-legal importance of tattoos. With that, our session on identity themes is closed, and you can also get SCQs and questions on identity from past papers and revise your subject. Thank you.